Hi everyone, it's Mrs. Caskey back with another chapter book read aloud. The book that we are currently reading is called Story Thieves. I hope that you have listened to chapter 1 and chapter 2. I really like this story. So where we left off was Owen has figured out that Bethany can be a fictional character and that she can jump in and out of books. And they jumped into a couple different books. Hopefully you'll remember one of them was War of the Worlds, right in the middle of the war. And then they jumped into the book Through the Looking Glass, which is the Alice in Wonderland story. And so at the end of chapter 2, Bethany's kind of shown Owen, you know, how to jump in and out of books, or how she jumps in and out of books. And they jump out, and Owen faints. And Bethany says, "Alien invasions and rocking horse flies are fine, but this you faint at?" Because she was showing him how she could kind of like start to put her fingers into a book and her fingers would turn into words. And Owen fainted, so. So now we're on to chapter 3. I hope you enjoy this book because I really like it. I mean, it's hard to put down. Okay. Owen woke up to his mother calling him and immediately pushed himself upright, looking around quickly for ray guns or white rabbits or something. Unfortunately, there was nothing but a cleaned up children's section. No, 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 no. Had he dreamed all of that? Did that mean he really was still stuck in real life? Ugh. Owen, his mother shouted again, what's taking you so long? Sorry, I was just reading, he shouted back to her, and then he grabbed his Kyle Noman footbook and he ran to the front of the library, getting more and more depressed with every step. No, it had to be real. If it was real, then that meant that there was more to life than boring classes and boring chores after school and boring everything else. Bethany jumping into books was the opposite of boring, and therefore it had to be real. If life was going to be fair at all, it had to be real. Owen spent that night staring at the ceiling, waiting to sleep and not even feeling a sliver tired. Would Bethany be in school tomorrow? Would she deny it all? Had he just made it all up? And if not, how did she do it? What did she do in the books? Just explore, or did she mostly go for eating fictional candy? Who had she met? Did she have any autographs? Sometime during the night, he must have fallen asleep because his alarm pulled him out of dreams of Bethany introducing him to Aslan the Lion, as the people of Narnia cheered. Owen slapped the alarm off and then leapt out of bed, wide awake, despite getting almost no sleep. His mother asked him if everything was okay, as he almost choked on his breakfast and then he raced out the door, easily 20 minutes before the bus. When it finally came, Owen sat alone in the very first seat, his legs shaking from nervousness and excitement the entire way. He pushed his way off the bus as fast as he could and speedwalked to class, so he wouldn't get in trouble for running. Once there, he took his seat and he waited, the first one to show up. Other kids filed in, none of them looking happy to be there. And more than a few gave him an odd look as he sat at his desk, grinning in anticipation. He couldn't help it, though. Bethany would be there soon, and then he'd get his answers. It had to be real. It just made so much more sense than math and school and chores. Mr. Barbary stepped in, and the bell rang a second later with no sign of Bethany. Owen almost slapped his desk in frustration. Where was? And then Bethany slid in the door right behind Mr. Barbary. She edged along the side of the room and quickly took her seat, sitting down just as Mr. Barbary turned around to start class, completely missing the fact that she was late. Owen glanced over his shoulder at her as subtly as he could, but Bethany had her eyes locked on the front of the room, where Mr. Barbary had started talking about geography. Owen groaned. So what? He'd have to wait till lunch now to talk to her? Life was both boring and very, very cruel. What followed were the worst 3 hours that Owen had ever experienced, like Christmas Eve, the night before vacation, and waiting for the new Kyle Noman foot to come out, all rolled into one. Minute by minute rolled by, and Owen was so frustrated, he didn't even bother daydreaming. Instead, he threw looks back at Bethany, who seemed to be paying more attention to Mr. Barbary than anyone had ever before in all of history. Finally, the lunch bell rang, and Owen had to hold himself down, letting the rest of the class leave before him. Bethany seemed to be waiting, too, but seeing that he wasn't going anywhere, she quickly got up and left, ignoring him when he called out her name as she passed. Owen paused, and he psyched himself up and then walked out directly behind her, following her to the cafeteria. She sat down alone at a table with her paper bag lunch, and he sat down right across from her, completely lunchless. "Hi," he said, grinning widely. She sighed loud enough to be sure he heard, and then she gave him a dirty look. "What?" "What are you reading?" he asked, pointing at the book next to her lunch tray. She flipped the book over even as he asked about it. "None of your business." "Is it any good?" She made an annoyed growling sound. "Owen, tell me what you want." She lowered her voice to a whisper. "Are you going to blackmail me or something? Turn me into the library police? All unless I jump you into a book and steal a time machine or something?" Well, that threw him. "Blackmail? A time machine? Where would you get that?" She glared at him. "From The Time Machine, it's a book, and the title kind of gives it away. Duh." "Oh, right," he said. "But no, I just came over here because, honestly, I thought I might have imagined the whole thing. But you saying it happened makes me feel so much better," and he grinned again. She stared at him, open-mouthed, and then she rolled her eyes. "This is what I get for not letting you talk first." "So how does it work?" Owen whispered, looking around to make sure no one else was watching or listening. "How does what work?" She looked tired of this whole conversation. "You doing, well, whatever it is you do, with that finger-waving in Wonderland and bringing us into the War of the Worlds?" She glanced around. "Can we not talk about this here, in the middle of the cafeteria? Everyone is staring at us." Owen glanced in the direction she nodded in, but saw no one looking at them. He turned back and he realized she'd been about to make a run for it. "Nice try," he said, standing up too. "We can go somewhere else, but you're not running away into a book or something, not without me." "Is that a threat?" she demanded, giving him a cold glare. "Nope," his confusion making his smile fade. "You can't now know how amazing this is, how it makes up for everything. I knew that there was something like this out there, because if there wasn't, life was just dental floss and vegetables and word problems, and that can't be everything. Deep down, I think we all know there has to be more. So for books to be real, to know they're out there, all my favorite characters, that would make it all worth it." She stared at him for a moment, and then she shook her head. "Oh, I'm an idiot for ever talking to you. But if I tell you about it, will you promise to never tell anyone?" Owen crossed his heart, and she rolled her eyes again. "Not good enough?" he asked. "How about I solemnly swear that I am up to no good?" "Don't marauders map me," she told him. "I'll talk to you at the library tonight. Until then, you don't speak to me, look at me, or even know I exist. Now, leave me alone." Owen beamed and stood up to go get his food, too excited to eat, but knowing he'd better since he might need his strength. There'd have to be dragons, whatever story they visited tonight, and magic. Oh, and spaceships and aliens who weren't allergic to human colds, and flying squirrels and volcanoes and super spies, probably, and everything else he couldn't even imagine right now. All this time, his favorite books hadn't been lying. All you had to do was wait long enough, last through enough boring lessons on fractions, live through enough chores and homework and evil stepmothers, and eventually you found something better. A fairy godmother, a dying alien with a power ring, or a doorway to a magical world. And Owen's doorway just happened to be a girl named Bethany. The rest of the day went by in a blur, mostly because Owen didn't even bother trying to pay attention. Instead, he went through all of his favorite books in his head, trying to pinpoint which one they should go into first. Obviously, Harry Potter would be near the top of the line. Did you hear that, Gracie? Harry Potter. Not even to Hogwarts, just to Ollivander's for a wand. That'd be perfect. Next, the Lightning Thief, and then the Graveyard Book, and a trip to Fablehaven, and then Owen stopped short, right in the middle of the sidewalk, as he walked home from the bus. What was he thinking? What was everyone at school talking about? The 7th Kyle Nomenfoot book out next week. And why? Because they all wanted to find out if the Magister had lived, and if not, to see Kyle get revenge on Dr. Verity. But what if someone saved the Magister? What if someone saved the Magister from Dr. Verity? What if Bethany brought Owen into the book right at the moment when Dr. Verity attacked, and Owen stopped him? He would be a hero in a book, a hero in a book that everyone read. Owen's mouth dropped open and pure joy exploded in his chest. Oh, this would be huge, bigger than saving Dumbledore, since Dumbledore came back anyway as a ghost or whatever he was. The Magister was like everyone's favorite character after Kyle. It might even change how the books ended. That was it. None of the tourists, autograph type stuff. Clearly Owen had been pulled out of his boring world for exactly this reason. It was meant to be fate or something, and he'd been chosen, and it was time to save the greatest wizard ever, the Magister. And all Owen had to do to make it happen was convince Bethany to take him with her. That's the end of chapter 3. Are you wondering about Kyle Nomenfoot and Dr. Verity and the Magister? Have you heard of any of them? No, that's because they're only in this story. So even though some of the books in the story that we've been hearing, like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory by Roald Dahl, or Alice in Wonderland, or War of the Worlds, those are real books, right? And some of you I know have read them. Oh, The Lightning Thief, Harry Potter series. Those are all real books, but this particular book that they're talking about, or book series that they're talking about, the Kyle Nomenfoot series, it's not real. So maybe that's because they don't want us to try to jump into those stories and change them. I don't know. But okay, so we will look at chapter 4. And until then, I say goodbye and keep reading.